I remember talking to Imam Zayd before, a few years back, because I still to this day I get detractors, but I remember asking him before, because it was starting to get to me. And it was when I was doing my PhD at the time. And I said, Sheikh, you know, people are telling me, like, you know, just focus on one thing. Just do your PhD in neuroscience. Stop it with this, all this seeking of Islamic knowledge, really trying to be also a theologian scholar. And at the same time, this, you can't do these things all at the same time. And Imam Zayd is like, his words still ring to with me. That I have him, like the Arabs say, the Egyptians say, حُطَّ حَلَى عَلَى أُدَانَكَ, you know, make it an earring for you so that you always remember it. That people will try to bring you downward to where they are. People don't want, when they see people doing multiple things and excelling at them, that intimidates them because it reminds them that, like, oh man, you could be doing a lot more with what you have. So he's like, what are you upset about? You're just doing two things. You're just doing a PhD in neuroscience and you're seeking Islamic knowledge at the same time. That's just two things. You're not doing a lot of things. So relax. So, and now I'm starting to see how they all intersect and they all come together. And if you look at Muslim scholars of the past, if you look at what they wrote about and the things that they engaged in, they were multiple things. They weren't just a one-trick pony, if you, you know, for lack of a better phrase. But now you have people that go into Sharia school or like Islamic studies, and that's all they do. And then they come out after 6, 7, 8 years. I remember there's an imam, may Allah preserve him, Imam Yahya in Vancouver, the mosque that I go to when I'm there in Burnaby. And he did the iftah for a year. After he finished his study, he did iftah for a year before he just, like, he's done. And then he went and he wanted to be an imam for a while. And he's just kind of progressing through his life, however he, you know, wherever the roads take him. And he said to me that he noticed something that was interesting. People that do iftah, that's all they do. And when he says all they do, meaning they just sit in the library. They just sit with books. They get the questions and they go through the references and that's all they do. And that's it. And he's like, so when you hear, and the way he phrased it was really interesting. He says something like, when you hear some crazy fatwas sometimes coming out, it's because they're sitting in the library. They're not out there with the people.
He has the ivory tower thing.
You know what I call them, Sidi? Life. You know what I call them, Sidi? I call them outdated human computers.
Yes. Yeah, they are. So it's like, you remember
that Microsoft, it's a Microsoft system, OS system is like 2000.
Bro, that's I was going to say, like, even older than that. Do you remember those big huge square floppy I might be revealing my age with this. Like, I come from an era where it's like MS-DOS. You know,
I remember MS-DOS. I hated it.
Yeah, so it's like he said, when you hear these crazy fatwas coming out of people, it's because they're not out there with the people. So they go through the books. And I had a question, actually. Somebody asked me. He was trying to share this thing, and he was kind of almost rebuked for drawing a lesson from it, from something from the seerah. And the rebukation came in the form of, well, Sheikh so-and-so, in his commentary on this text, he said that this is the way that it is. And so I'm just, you know, letting you know so that you don't go out and say these things. And so he was a little bit troubled by it. And he's like, did I say anything wrong? He was just asked, like, the thing that I just mentioned, is there anything wrong with this? I said, well, the problem is, you didn't say anything wrong. What you said is actually in line with the hadith. It's in line with the implicit understanding that you can derive from it. It's not contradicting anything from the sunnah. It's not contradicting anything from the Quran. But the problem with so-called orthodox or traditionalists, or however people want to identify themselves these days, everybody wants to give themselves a label. The way that they approach things is they're so worried about the modern world and the isms of the modern world that when they see anything from Islam being interpreted or promoted in a way that even goes in line with something that some ism is promoting, they respond to that ism. They're not responding to what you're saying. They're responding to the ism. And so they're trying to, and they're trying to project. They're taking, you know, I'm always telling people, do not project modern sensibilities and modern norms that we have onto the Islamic tradition. That's a very dangerous line of thinking to go in. So for you, for example, to say, oh, you know, I'm a feminist or I'm a liberalist or whatever it is that you want to be, and then you want to take that and you want to project it onto the text and then reinterpret the Quran and twist it and bend it however which way you want so that you can show Islam to be, oh, Islam is a feminist religion, Islam is a liberal. I said, don't do that. But at the same time, don't go into the past the works of the scholars, as great as they are, you know, and all kudos to them and much respect to them and all the du'as to them, because they're the ones that transmitted this tradition. We only know about the Sunnah and the Quran and the Hadith and all these things because of these people. So you have to elevate their status. Like we trust them to deliver these things to us, so you can't trash them. But at the same time, recognize that socially, contextually, they lived in a different time. And so they interpret it scientifically also. So their take, with the lessons they drew, you know, their interpretation beyond this limits of language. I'm talking about just the general lessons that you can draw from something, from the text. They're colored by their context. So don't turn Islam into a culturally hegemonic force that you don't want to project things from the modern time onto the tradition. And at the same time, you don't want to project things from the past onto the modern times. These same scholars, as great as they are, they wrote laws and rulings regarding slavery. And it's almost like people nowadays think of employment as like a given thing. And only recently do people now think about, like, do you really have to work 9 to 5? Can you change your condition? People are now talking about universal income and minimum income and all these things. These are new things. But if you go back even 10 years ago, it's like a fish doesn't know that it's in water. You know what I mean? So these scholars at the time, they didn't know that they were in a system that basically takes a human being's freedom and puts it under somebody else's, where they control it. And so a lot of rulings and things came out of that. I'm not going to judge them, because that's like judging a fish for living in water. Like, that's just the way that things were done, and it is the way that it is, and we moved on from that. And actually, you have in the tradition, there is this scholar from Timbuktu, Ahmed bin Babat Timbukti.
Yeah.
His work is only in manuscripts. I haven't seen anybody that's come out with like an actual print edition of stuff. But this scholar from Timbuktu, he wrote, he's a Maliki scholar. He's got writings about, you know, these are the rulings for slaves and stuff. He was captured, enslaved in the caliph's court in Morocco somewhere. And he was a slave. He was a slave scholar and was considered a scholar, but he wasn't freed until that caliph, that ruler, died. When he died, he was freed. When he came back, he started to write against slavery. He's like, let me just think this thing over again. I was writing from within the box of, this is my worldview. But it wasn't until I was impacted personally by this thing that I'm a slave now. I've lost my freedom. Now he started to think differently about it. And it wasn't that he was going against the Quran in any way. It's just that there are some things, you know, when we talk about the trajectory of the Quran with slavery, was to promote emancipation, was to get rid of it. Well, you kind of have to be outside of that paradigm, that worldview, for you to see that.
Right.
Right? Yeah. And so it wasn't until he actually got personally impacted by these things, and he's like, wait a minute, there's something wrong with this. مَتَ اسْتَعْبَدْتُمُ النَّاسَ وَقَدْ وَلَدَتْهُمْ أُمَّهَاتُهُمْ أَحْرَارًا. You know the words of Umar al-Khattab radiallahu anhu. When did you enslave people when their mothers gave birth to them as free people? And Umar al-Khattab is a very interesting, significant. He's a, you know, people have different, you know, we love all the Sahaba, but for whatever reason, I don't know what it is about Umar, but he holds like a special place in my heart. And there's something about Umar al-Khattab that the Prophet ﷺ said about him, had there been prophethood after him, it would have gone to Umar. There is a reason for that, because he was seeing through things. He saw things. He was working with his fitrah. So that's what I mean by, like, just don't project things from the modern to the past, but don't make the past also hegemony onto the modern times. Yeah, there are some things today that are problematic. Well, identify the problematic things. You know, the Prophet ﷺ said that he was not sent except for to لِوْتَمِّمَ مَكَارِمَ الْأَخْلَاقِ, to complete noble characteristics and qualities. Take the positive, throw out the negative, point out the negative. Yeah. If your thing says something that's in line with something, I'll give you another example. I don't even know how we got to this, but I'm just talking.
Yeah, we can weave some of this. I think some of the stuff might come up when we actually talk about.
Okay.
What we might be talking about.
My bad. I'm just
because I think we need to get warmed up. Ghaidar wanted to hear you for a little bit to get himself warmed up. I think he's warmed up now.
Yeah, I kind of was like, subhanAllah, you know, we could have just started another podcast just casually, you know, but what are you going to do with these traditionalists? You know, they don't know what to do unless they box themselves
You know what? I love them. I love them so much. And the ghira, you know, the jealousy that they have, the concern that they have for the tradition and the preservation of the sunnah, of the sunnah of the Prophet, of the Quran, of proper understanding. You know, you cannot, these are the people, you know, we can try to dog them a little bit here and there and point out these things, but you know what? Those traditionalists are the reason why we still have the ancillary tools, the grammar, the proper interpretive methodology, all of these things. I might have a problem with how they apply some things and how they might understand something. But you know what? They're the upholders of the tools that we approach this thing with. And so you have to pay homage to that and say like, Jazakumullahu khairan. This is amazing. And we are indebted to you guys. So,
of course. All right.
So I guess we'll start for the official part.
Oh, okay.
All right, bismillah.